Thank you to Athletic Greens for sponsoring today's video. Their sponsorship to help make this winter off-grid a reality.
Hey everybody, I am Chris.
And I'm Linnea.
And we are attempting to live completely off the grid without leaving for 3 months in our tiny homes. So today we're going to give you a full tour of both of our rigs, as well as the land and how we live out here.
We are going to start with the bus and then move on to my van. If you want to see the full tours of both vehicles, they're available in the description below. This is going to be a little bit different than a typical tour. We are going to focus mainly on the upgrades of our rigs and the things that we're doing to really thrive out here over winter.
All right, everyone, welcome to my school bus conversion. As you can see, this is a raised roof Skoolie conversion, and this winter off-grid is really putting this bus to the test. What we're gonna do is section the bus off into three different sections. So we're gonna start in the back of the bus because as we're out here, that is where we spend about 75, 80% of our time while we're indoors. So we're gonna start with the back of the bus and then the living room of the bus. And then we actually utilize the very front of the bus as our fridge area just to keep things cold. Let's go ahead and head back to the back of the bus. This is our queen size bed. It does face north to south. That's been working for us really well. Also, we added two uppers to the build before this winter, one on the passenger side here and another on the driver's side here. The reason for that is for example, right here, this used to be all clothes storage. Now it's battery storage. We did a lot of rearranging, adding a bunch of different gear and using the existing storage to put the winter gear in. So we had to find a new spot for our clothes. That's where the uppers came in. Also, in terms of storage, the bed actually lifts up, and that's where our canned food is.
So one of our goals for this winter was to be as self-sustaining as we could be. So we challenged ourselves to learn how to can this past summer. We started with more simple things like water bath canning. So we have a few pickled goods. We ended up pickling cucumbers and dilly beans, as well as mushrooms, and we're almost all out already, which has been a big bummer. We know to do more for next year. After we learned how to do the water bath canning, we graduated to the pressure canning. So we do have a lot of what we call like ready-made meals. We have bison chili and chicken soup. And these were really fun to learn how to do, and we really had no idea how they were going to taste. We had read a lot about canning meat in different ways, and we really weren't sure if they were going to end up tasting good and how the textures would change after the pressure canning, but we love these and we rely on them a lot. We wanted to make sure to can a lot of variety, so right now I'm holding applesauce and peaches. We knew that because we don't have a lot of freezer space and fridge space, we needed a different options, not just for meals, for like dinner, but for snacks and also sweet things. So because we did a lot with apples, homemade applesauce, and we also have homemade pie filling, this gives us the opportunity to make sweet desserts or have sweet snacks because we also don't have much of that up here. So along with all of this food that you guys can see underneath the bed, we do have meat stored elsewhere, and Chris will get to that later. And the intention of doing all of this to get our fruits and vegetables and different types of meat is to really make sure that we have lots of nutrients because we're not allowing ourselves to leave the property or go to the grocery store throughout the winter. Which leads me to the sponsor for today's video. Huge thanks to Athletic Greens for helping us really fill the gaps in our nutritional diet while being out here in the Northwoods this winter.
So as Linnea said, one of our main priorities was making sure our nutrition was on point during this winter. Being that we were not allowed to leave for the 3.5 months we were out here, we needed something to basically complete our nutritional diet. That is where AG1 comes in. So part of our morning routine actually includes AG1. While Linnea's making coffee, I am making this for the both of us. We try and make this an everyday routine because, as I said before, we don't have any greens out here.
So I have been drinking AG1 for nearly 2 years now. And one of the things that I really love about it is that it includes many different health products or vitamins in one. So living in a small space, clutter is not a thing you like to have. So for me, having this nutritional drink that acts as like a multivitamin and a mushroom complex all in one is quite essential for living in a small space.
Click my link below to get a 1 year supply of immune supporting vitamin D3, K2, and 5 travel packs free with your first purchase of AG1. So moving forward from the back of the bus to the front, one of the storage changes that we did was this cabinet right here. We actually swapped out 9 Battleborne batteries for 4 sock batteries. The Battleborne batteries used to live down here between the wheel wells, upgraded the solar system completely for this winter off-grid. We have learned a ton about power preservation, about trying to charge, about solar. It was a big investment going with the sock batteries. Went with 2 Victron 5,000 watt Quattro inverters, upgraded the solar on the roof. We still run out of power from time to time. I'll show you the generator outside shortly. Overall, one of my biggest concerns coming into this winter was the power. And being that we are surrounded by trees, being that it has been cloudy more so than not, like I would say we get a sunny day, maybe 1 out of every 10 days. It really hasn't been a game that we're learning in terms of charging our laptops, in terms of charging our phones. Every single little power draw we've been conscious of. As Linnea goes a little bit further into the front of the bus, we'll detail how we actually removed the chest freezer and how we don't use the fridge and freezer anymore in the bus just because it drew so much power. Now we just use the outside to cool everything. But overall, upgrading the power system was a big part of prepping for winter off-grid. And I am very glad that we actually went with these larger capacity batteries because it allows us to store a lot of the power from the generator.
So this right here, this little nook, is probably my favorite space in the entire bus because we have the wood stove right here and this little seat along with this shelf. This did not look this way just a few months ago. There had been a diesel heater here, and thanks to Dark Wolf Artisans, they did a beautiful job installing this wood stove from Tiny Wood Stoves. There was never a wood stove in here prior, and we were unsure how it was going to heat the bus, but this kicks off a lot of heat and keeps us very comfortable. One of the most common questions that we get asked is how it does throughout the night. So right now, and about for the last week, we haven't even been running it throughout the night because the temperatures have really only been getting down to about 15 degrees Fahrenheit or so. There was a cold streak where the temps were getting to like negative 20s, negative 30s, and we would stock the wood stove halfway through the night, so at about 1 or 2 in the morning, and then when we woke up again around 5 or 6 in the morning, and it kept us very comfortable. One thing to note that has been a great little addition are these separators. In the evenings or when it gets really cold, we will shut this and it really traps the heat in this back area. So sleeping is very comfortable and warm, and we spend a lot of time here working or reading, drinking coffee, whatever it may be. So when dealing with tiny homes, condensation is always kind of a hot topic, and with this wood stove, it's important to note that wood heat is dry heat. So we have not experienced condensation except for one day or one evening, and that was when we did our laundry. We ended up drying our laundry in this space so that it could be dried from the wood stove. And there was a lot of condensation. It did cover the walls, but really it only took that night for the condensation to go away. And we filled the wood stove that next morning and left this open, so the heat went through the entire bus and dried things out very quickly. We also have a little thermometer that has a humidity reading on it, and it is almost always reading between 10 to 15% humidity. Of course, when we did the laundry, it was higher than that, but overall condensation is not an issue this winter. Other than the practical aspect of a wood stove, the ambiance of it and how cozy it is probably my favorite part. There's really nothing better than waking up in the morning, getting a small fire going, and sitting here relaxing as this lightens the place before the sun comes up. It's wonderful. We also use this a lot for cooking or heating things up. So the kettle right now that you can see, that is how we heat water, all the water from coffee to showering. And when we crack open our canned goods, if we want chili for that night, we'll throw it in a plate and put it on top of the wood stove and heat it up that way. We toast our bread on there. A really great addition has been a metal grate that Wes from Dark Wolf Artisans made specifically to fit this wood stove. So we put the grate in the wood stove when it has worked down to just coals, and that's how we grill steaks and pieces of meat, and it is incredible. Of course, we've added a wood organizer, which is needed so that we don't have to go outside every day and bring in armfuls of wood, and this lasts us about a day and a half to 2 days. We also added this little shelf up here, and the importance of this ties back into our nutrition for sure. This shelf is what allows us to grow 2 mason jars full of sprouts that we eat every week, and this is also where I place my sourdough starter to make bread every week.
Since I bought the bus, I've had a Nature's Head composting toilet. Off-grid situations, it's been great. There is no flushing aspect to it. We have had to change the solids, the poo side of the composting toilet twice. We have a bin outside that we put that in, I think it's a 24-gallon typical Home Depot tote with a lid. We'll dispose of that after we're done here. With the urine, the liquids, we do have a 30-gallon tank. We try not to use this toilet for that. We typically just try and go outside. But if it's middle of the night, we don't feel like going out, we will use that. And we're trying to see if that 30 gallons will last the entire time we're out here. On the other side of the Nature's Head composting toilet, we have a 32 by 32 shower. We do not have running water right now. We had a very cold streak and it basically froze the lines. The water pump froze through. I do have 2 spare water pumps, but we decided to try and do everything with no running water. So right now the shower doesn't work, but what we have, they're not sponsoring this video, but we really love them. Nemo shower. This is a foot pedal shower, and this has been working really well for us because what we are able to do is just use the river water. We put a kettle on the wood stove. We heat that up and then basically 1-to-1 hot water to the cold water that we have, and that creates an awesome shower. I'm a type of person that loves to shower. I hate going to bed sticky, and having this option has been a lifesaver. We use it for more than showers, but so far, this has been working really well. Also, one last thing with the shower, we did recently do laundry for the first time out here. We used coolers, just a hand agitator, and we had a drying rack when we used the shower to dry clothes. Even though we don't have running water in here, we still use this space, we still utilize this space, and it's been working really well.
And moving a little bit more forward in the bus, I was just sitting back there chatting about the wood stove, and this is the kitchen. So this is where we do our cooking. This is a propane stove. Propane is limited for us while we're up here, so we do our best not to cook on the stove or use the oven for like long periods of time. So we'll show this later, but we do a lot of cooking in the Dutch oven out on the fire for long meals like stews or brisket or bread. But occasionally we will use this for sauteing things or quick meals. As for a few cool, unique things, here is an example of a jar of sprouts that we eat every week. And over here is where we keep one of our large jars of water glassed eggs. So in here are farm fresh eggs. These are not cooked. Often people think that these are hard boiled before placed in this solution, but these are completely raw. So this is a solution with unwashed farm fresh eggs placed in it. And these can be good for up to or around 2 years. Chris and I will use these for things like meatloaf. We just hard boiled some eggs the other day and they taste great. So this is our large sink with a lot of dishes in it right now because we cook and eat and don't do dishes every day. But when we do dishes, we use the Nemo shower, which Chris mentioned when we were talking about the bathroom. This actually works beautifully for dishes. It also allows us to conserve water. One of the reasons as well why dishes are still in the sink is because we have a water filtration system since we gather our water from the river. So right now we're waiting for water to filter through the Berkey because that is usually what we use to wash the dishes. So this is the original fridge and freezer. Both of these are high efficiency, but for what we're doing out here and the lack of sun that we've been getting each day, we decided to not use these. Under this butcher block used to be a large chest style freezer. This housed a lot of our frozen meats and a few other frozen goods, but we realized that it was just drawing too much energy and we could just take advantage of the very cold outdoors rather than relying on a chest freezer inside and drawing energy where we didn't have to. A positive to moving that chest freezer outside is also now having all of this storage under here for a few propane tanks and also our water, which leads me into our water filtration system. So these blueies that you see down here, we carry these down to the river and fill them up with river water. We bring them back up to the bus and the water first goes through this Berkey. This is mainly just to get out any like sediment or leaves or twigs. Once the water is filtered through the Berkey, we then take that and fill up the platypus. So the platypus is a gravity fed filter system. It's very quick and it does 4 liters at a time. And that is what we use for our drinking water, where the Berkey water we use for dishes, boiling eggs, things that we're not directly consuming, just to stay safe.
So Linnea just finished with the middle section of the bus. This is the very front of the bus. As you can see, we have 2 blankets. I just have marine clips that are able to hold this blanket up. This basically separates the very cold front because this is single pane window up here. It's also very breezy. Helps us retain some of the heat moving further back into the bus. But because of that, what we're able to do is actually have a little fridge. This is just a tote that we picked up right before we came out here. And we just keep all the condiments and also leftovers. So far, this has been working really well. As Linnea said, we no longer have a fridge or freezer inside, but this in-between zone from the wood stove in here, as well as this cold area, it doesn't get cold enough to actually freeze the stuff up here. It keeps it about 30, 35 degrees, somewhere around there throughout the day and night. So this has been working really well as a fridge unit for us.
So welcome to my home. This is my full-time rig when we are not in the Northwoods living off-grid. So about 3 years ago, I started this build and I built this entire thing out by myself, very proud of it. And there are a few things that I ended up changing to prepare for living up here. The main change has been this wood stove right here. So this is a cubic mini wood stove. It's the Cub model. Originally, I had a Chinese diesel heater underneath this seat right here. And while there were so many benefits to having that diesel heater, the wood stove definitely suits my lifestyle better at this point after 2 full years on the road. As for the install of this wood stove, Cubic Mini has a really great instruction manual and awesome support team. It was quite easy, and the only thing that I wish I could have done differently would be to put it lower to the ground. But because my van was already completely built out, it was just an addition, and this was the best place to put it. As for the heat that this puts off, for it being such a tiny wood stove, it does throw off a good amount of heat. When we are hanging out on the bed, I am very comfortable. The only reason that I mentioned why it would be nice to have it lower is because the ground does stay quite cool, which is nice in a way for having my fridge and freezer down low because those are currently not on. My solar setup with my van is also having a hard time, so I basically only use the lights and all other electrical appliances have been turned off. As you might guess, the bus is much more suited for 2 people and it's more set up for this style of winter living where we're parked here and we're staying. As for the van, this is very much my home and my cozy space, so I like to be over here and work throughout the day. I like to sleep in the van every now and then. I am a cold sleeper. I sleep really well when it's cold. I don't even use the wood stove at night. Akilah and I just cuddle up underneath our negative 40 sleeping bag and our blankets. And I sleep really well over here compared to the bus bed, which is so close to the wood stove. I get very hot over there. So this is kind of my little getaway when Chris and I, you know, want some space or we have specific work to get done, or if I just want to sleep in my little house.
So what you see here is where all of our power has been coming from. This is a Honda GX620. It's a V-twin generator and it runs on propane. Right now I have 30 amp service, so it will bring in about 3000 watts when the generator is running. It does run on propane, as I said, and I do have a total of 8 propane tanks. Right now we are down to about 3.5-4 tanks. The reason why I don't know for certain is basically when I'm running this propane generator, it takes so much propane and it's cold outside, the propane tanks actually freeze up and it doesn't allow enough propane into the generator for it to run at full capacity. So basically 2 full propane tanks right now and about 3 of them that are half full. Without this, we would not have power out here. I did upgrade the solar to about 2100 watts, but again, with all the tree cover, with the lack of sun we've had out here, basically it's been a game of maintaining the solar throughout the day, just trying to keep it equal. And then when we need to actually charge our laptops or any larger gear, we have to kick this on. We're hoping the propane lasts for the rest of the time we're out here. All right, so some of the crucial gear that I am glad that I brought that I didn't think about till I was out here. I did pick this up before we came out here. This is just a brush with a squeegee on the back. With the amount of snow we get out here, this thing has been an absolute lifesaver. I also have a Louisville ladder. I had one of those telescoping ladders that most RVers have. It actually broke on me and I was all the way up there and I almost fell off the side of the bus because that broke. Lesson learned, always have a good ladder. But this has been crucial going up there, cleaning off the panels whenever we do get sun or any type of ambient light, even through the cloud cover, every watt counts out here. So this has been vital. And a little pro tip that I've learned while I've been out here, I do have one of those electric blowers that you can get for shops or whatever. I go up there, I use the brush, and then I have the blower as well. When it's nice, light, powdery snow, the combination of this brush with the forced air behind it cleans the panels right off.
So this right here, which is kind of hidden with snow and ice right now, this is our root cellar. About 3 weeks before we officially like moved up here for the winter, I came up here and I dug this. Of course, one of the things that we wanted to make sure we had was vegetables. So this root cellar is unique in the way that it's really just a garbage can. It is a large galvanized steel garbage can that has been dug and placed into the ground below ground level or right at ground level. From there, the vegetables are just layered inside with straw. So we have potatoes, carrots, and beets, and all of those vegetables came from my mom's garden. She grew them, and thankful for her, we can now just come out to the root cellar, take the tarp off, remove some of the insulation and the straw, and we have vegetables that are not frozen. And we've found that this works really, really well. It's also great because it's not permanent. So if after this year or the next few years, if we want to change location of the root cellar or not have it up here at all, we can just dig that metal garbage can out and no root cellar.
So on the rare occasion that we actually do get sun, we do have 2 Jackery battery banks. So each one of those has 200 watts of panels. So basically what we call this little area outside of the bus is our solar array, our little solar farm that we have set up. You'll also notice that there is a tote behind me. That is because the Jackeries have a built-in safety feature that doesn't allow them to charge if the temperatures are too low. And when we had the cold streak overnight, what we're running into is the sun would be out, but the Jackeries wouldn't charge. So what I did was I took one of our totes, put a sleeping bag in there, which allows us to have the Jackeries inside, put them next to the wood stove, warm up, bring them out to the battery box, put them, like wrap them in the sleeping bags, and then they're able to charge throughout the day. The Jackeries have been a nice little addition. However, the issue that we're facing is even when we have the Jackeries charging, you know, they're warm in their little battery box there, they don't get direct sunlight just because there's so many trees around. So it's been more supplementary power, more like cell phones and camera batteries. But when it comes down to our laptops, typically we can't get one full charge, but it has been nice just having an extra 400 watts sitting out, gathering as much power as possible.
Usually we take these Blueys and we put it on a sled. We bring the sled all the way down here and break through this ice with this. Usually when we know that it's going to be really cold or freeze over overnight, we will place these pine boughs on top of the hole, cover that with snow for insulation, and that allows us to access our water without needing to pickaxe it. I just wanted to mention, oh, I thought that was a lot thicker. See, it hasn't been very cold. That just had a really thin thing of ice. Generally, we gather two Blueys full of water about every 2 days, 2 to 3 days, depending on how many dishes we're doing or if we're needing water for other things. And it has very quickly became both of our favorite chores to do. Coming down here and just being by the river, it's very silent, it's beautiful. This doesn't take very long. We use the pitcher to fill up our Blueys, and it's a really beautiful chore where we just get to be present and be in nature, and we really do enjoy it. When we are down here filling up water, we are cautious with the dogs and not allowing them to cross the river because there is a decent flow right here and you never know how thin the ice is. Also, when we do show how we get water, there are often a lot of suggestions to rig up some sort of water pump or like siphon, but this just works really well. It's efficient, it doesn't take long, and like I mentioned before, we both really enjoy it, so we don't feel the need to, I guess, waste any more electricity by using something like an electrical water pump. This is our main outdoor area with a fire for hanging out and cooking. I do all of the Dutch oven cooking here on this fire. It's really nice to have a table out here for projects, cooking, setting stuff on, and overall, because obviously it's cold, it's snowy, having an area to start a fire, Chris and I will sit here and just hang out or do projects, and this just allows us to have a space where we're not only spending time inside the bus or the van. So right now there is a small fire going with coals that I'm building up to bake bread. So I'm on my second loaf of bread for today. Bread is the main thing that I cook in the Dutch oven, other than large chunks of meat like stew and brisket and things like that. So right now the Dutch oven is essentially preheating, like you would preheat an oven. And then I will place my bread dough in the oven and cover it with coals and wait 30 to 40 minutes. I always cook sourdough bread. That is my favorite. Today, due to just like the time that we had, I am making normal bread with active yeast. This also ties into really the goal. I think both Chris and I, we've wanted to kind of test our skills and see what we can learn and what we were capable of throughout the winter. And this is one of the things that I really wanted to learn. And it's been really fun to learn how to cook with a Dutch oven on a fire.
So behind me, you have my car and a wood pile. This is important because we have the car prepped and ready to go in case of an emergency. Since we've been out here, I did get a brown recluse bite. I did have to seek medical attention after keeping an eye on it for about 2 or 3 days. Having this out here just in case has been a safety feature that I wanted to have since the beginning. I knew I wanted to set it in a way that it could get out easily. And then I also keep the battery inside the bus next to the wood stove or close to the wood stove, just so the battery doesn't die. So we can head out here, throw the battery in, and we can get out if we need to. On top of being a safety escape if we need it, the car also serves as our freezer. So we have 3 coolers in here. Before we started this adventure, we got a quarter cow And we also got some venison from some friends. So all of that is stored out here. On top of that, on the other side of me, all this wood up here, you know, we originally thought that we'd have a ton of spare time out here. That has not been the case, but this is green oak that we got. We wanted to use this for building structures or any type of project that we might come across. So far, we've been so busy just with maintaining things out here and our work that we haven't had any progress on this. I will say that at very least, this will be firewood for us. It'll be seasoned out here, but we're still hoping to carve out some time to work on some of these projects. Another aspect of living out here is internet access. Both Linnea and I do work online. We both upload and download a lot of files. We do have a Starlink out here. We also have a hotspot. What I have found, if I get up at my normal time around 5 a.m. or so, from 5 to 7 a.m., the hotspot is incredibly fast. If there's something that pops up that we need to get done, we will power the Starlink up. It does not take that much wattage to run. Like, it's only like 60 or 80 watts, but when we're on such a energy deficiency day after day, it starts to add up. We will kick this on from time to time, but mostly we just use the hotspot, and we try and use the hotspot at times to when it's fast. Being that we are in such a remote area, there's only so much bandwidth with the cell towers, but we've been getting by with going in between the Starlink and the hotspot. So this is our wood prep area. We do have two different types of wood. Linnea came up during the summer to cut down some trees as well as cut up some dead trees. That's more softwood. We did invest in a cord and a half of kiln dried oak. The reason for that is we needed something that would last closer to overnight and something that would burn hotter if it did get incredibly cold out here. To be honest, the wood consumption has not been too bad. As you can see right now, I'm just in a jacket. I have thermals on with fire hose pants. The weather has not been too bad. I mean, the high of 34, 35 throughout the day most days. The wood stove doesn't consume that much wood other than in the mornings and the evenings when it's this temperature. So we have been doing very well with our wood consumption. And I will say, one of my favorite items out here, it's kind of a last second purchase, Makita electric chainsaw. As I mentioned with the generator, sometimes we have to power things up, draw a lot of power. The batteries for this draws a ton of power, but having this out here has been awesome.
All right, everybody, thank you so much for watching the tour of our off-grid camp. Both of our socials will be down below. Mine is the off-grid Skoolie.
And mine is Linnea and Akila.
And once again, I'd like to thank the sponsor of today's video, Athletic Greens. Their sponsorship definitely helped make this winter off-grid a reality. And to answer some of your questions, to go a little bit further in depth for those that are watching this long into the video and want to know a little bit more about the lifestyle, we have included a short Q&A after this section. So once again, thanks for watching.
Thank you.
Thank you. One of the questions somebody asked was the expectations versus reality. So I will start with my expectation was a lot of free time and a lot more difficult being out here than it actually is. The reality out here is definitely not that much free time. It is currently 3:11 and I have no clue where the day went. And it's not like I'm sitting around like I've been working online, meetings, cleaning for this video, editing this video, and tomorrow I have more meetings and more things to edit. Mm-hmm. How about you?
I also expected more free time. I think both of us, we kind of saw this as the light at the end of the tunnel because we were prepping so much during the summer and doing all of the things to our rigs to prepare. And then...
Real quick, no exaggeration, I'd say each of us at least 50 times. Probably closer to 100 times when we were busy, stressed.
Yeah.
We'd say to one another or ourselves, winter's coming up, we'll have a lot of free time then. Mm-hmm. Literally nonstop we said that.
So I stocked up on books, I was excited to do art, and little crafts, and yeah, no free time. Or very, very little free time. And... The other what is it? Expectation. The other expectation that I had was that the weather was going to be a lot worse, actually. I thought that, according to what I've heard, this winter was supposed to be really gnarly in Wisconsin, and it's been very mild, except for one short few days of negative 20 to negative 30. And who knows, there's still February.
So in terms of staying warm out here, as Linnea just said, the weather has not been that bad, but honestly, this is how I've learned about base layers, good base layers, and how important they are. The weather has been mild, so the wood stove, we really haven't been going through that much wood because it's been so mild.
Mm-hmm. Also, it's pretty amazing how the body adjusts to its environment. Like, we're getting more and more used to the cold, and our bodies are much more comfortable at lower temperatures, so that also happens, which is cool. But yeah, I mean, you hear the saying that there's no such thing as bad weather, just bad gear. So as long as you have good gear and you understand the layering system, you're good out in winter, outside. And
yeah, it's not bad.
Nope, not bad at all.
Our commitment structure.
Our commitment structure?
Yeah, so this was kind of a cool question. So Lynn actually had a really cool question I asked on the YouTube community page for questions. Said your commitment structure. How did the dream begin? How did you transition out of traditional home life, financial commitment, and processes? Finding the right bus and moving into the bus out of traditional home. The process of getting rid of possessions in order to live comfortably in a bus. So where I believe this is coming from is she's trying to imagine her current traditional house to living off the grid, whether she would want to do this or just the thought experiment of doing this. Mm-hmm. And I think it should be said for me in particular, I've never had a traditional home. Immediately out of college, I bought my first camper van, and I love this lifestyle, and I've always wanted to do this lifestyle where I've never signed a lease in my life. However, for you, mm-hmm. you did have the house. So mm-hmm. I think this would be more for you. For me, it's been something I've always dreamed about and I've just been working towards.
It's been something that I've dreamed about too and I've been working towards as well. I just had a different job right out of college. So, actually similar but different. So you moved into a camper van and you were working in the service industry. I moved out west to work in the backcountry. So while I had a traditional home, I was actually living in a basement with my brother and our good friend Nathan for a long time, and that was so fun. But yeah, I lived in a traditional home, but I was barely ever there because I was actually living out of my backpack in the desert for 8 days at a time. And I think, at least for me, it's just ever since I was about 19, I had wanted a lifestyle that was full of freedom and travel and experience. And so every step that I took in life brought me closer to achieving that. I think that as far as material possessions, I never actually owned a lot of things because I was always traveling and moving, and I wanted to be able to quickly get in my car and go travel somewhere else and go camping. And I spent my money on outdoor gear or experiences rather than material possessions that were maybe less of a necessity for what I wanted. And it was just an accumulation of experiences and then slowly taking the steps to be, you know, work remote, work for myself, create my own stable income. And eventually I was at a spot where I just went for the van and did the build, and that was my life. And
I think one point that we can both, at least I think it, we can come together on, is this homestead life. This isn't homestead, but I'm thinking of what we're doing here, people doing homesteads, people that want their own farm. The transition is going to take time, energy, and commitment. You have to have that North Star that you always go towards. At least that's how it's worked for me. And it sounds like it was the same for you. We were going in the same direction. We met and then we went in the same direction together to do this together. But, you know, if you are in the situation where you are in a traditional home, you have the goal, you just work towards it over time. And last question here that we didn't answer in the tour video was the insulation. So for the bus, I do have closed cell spray foam insulation with 3/4 inch plywood on the walls. All my windows are single pane. I never dreamed or imagined I would be living in winter in this thing. So that is a design flaw, but the spray foam insulation really does work well. There's been times to where we have to basically not have the wood stove on during the day in the more mild weather, because we'll start in the morning and the bus retains the heat. But as we mentioned in the video, the front section of the bus, the very front section, stays fairly chilled. The middle section stays warmish. And when we have the wood stove on, this back bedroom, bathroom area stays warm.
So in my van, I have 3M insulation in the ceiling and the walls. And then I do have an insulated floor. And really the beauty with the van is that it's so small. So even overnight, if Akilah and I are sleeping in there, or the four of us are sleeping in there, it stays at a pretty mild temperature just from our body heat. It doesn't take much at all for it to heat up, and it retains heat really well and stays cool in the summer too. So yeah, it's not as robust, or it doesn't have as high of an R value as the closed cell foam, but it does really great for what it needs to in such a small space.